Welcome to the 22nd video of Quantum Mechanics Done Right, the shortest path from novice to researcher. In this video, we're going to talk about chapter 16, which covers relativity and the Dirac equation. There's a picture of Paul Dirac on the left from around the time in which he developed the Dirac equation. And below, we have the Dirac equation itself, which is a linear equation. This would be the Dirac equation to find states of definite energy or energy eigenstates. And if you put the V of R equal to the Coulomb potential, it would solve for the energy eigenstates of hydrogen. That is the main problem that we look at in this chapter. Chapter 16, Relativity and the Dirac Equation. So we start by figuring out how to construct the Dirac equation. We get hints of this from work that Pauli did using the fact that sigma matrices, the Pauli matrices themselves, square to 1, allowing him to use a quasi-derivation that G is equal to 2 for electrons when you plug in a magnetic field. That actually provided a spark to allow Dirac to figure out the right way of generalizing it from a two-dimensional equation, which is what the Pauli equation is, into a four-dimensional equation, which is what the full Dirac equation is. We essentially use a little bit of relativity, the fact that E squared is equal to P squared C squared plus M squared C to the fourth. That's the guiding principle that we use to find the Dirac equation. Again, as Dirac did, we require the Dirac equation to be linear so that it has superposition and all of the kinds of behavior that quantum mechanics has. When you look at it, you can expand it in the limit where relativistic effects are small, and you can find that it does have the nonrelativistic Schrödinger equation buried inside of it. Once we have that, we then want to find the relativistic hydrogen eigenstates. Because the Dirac equation is linear in momentum and linear in energy, it doesn't exactly look like the kinds of equations we've been solving. There's a way of essentially squaring the Dirac equation. It's not exactly squaring, but it's very close to squaring the Dirac equation that allows us to then convert the Dirac equation into something that looks a lot like the Schrödinger equations that we have solved before. And then we can use our factorization method to solve them in a very similar way that we did before. One of the interesting aspects that comes about when we do this is that the energy eigenvalue ends up being on both sides of the equation. So the energy eigenvalue actually enters into our factorization, and that plays a role in our determining what the energy eigenvalues are. It also shows you that the result is a little bit complicated. Then we go on to determine what the relativistic hydrogen wave functions are. Our strategy is to map the problem onto a scalar problem. That essentially is already done by doing this squaring exercise that we did to find the hydrogen energy eigenstates. We then can find the quantum states in that factorization method, and then from that we can find the wave functions for the scalar part. But then we have to figure out how it goes back to the Dirac 4 spinner. And that requires us to do a fair amount of manipulations. It gets very tedious and complicated, so we really only carry out all of those steps for the 1s, 2s, and 2p states. Now, I must say, again, it's really French cooking. There's nothing particularly difficult. It's just the way that the problem works and how you have to go from states that have definite angular momentum to states that have other properties ends up just being a little bit complicated, and you just have to sit through and work through it. Then after all of that's done, we discuss what the Dirac equation does not include, because there are interesting things that are not in the Dirac equation. This includes the Lamb shift and the so-called G-2 effects. These are quantum electrodynamic effects primarily that cause renormalizations of energies due to interactions of the system essentially with vacuum fluctuations from the quantization of photons and the fact that photons interact with matter. And that is a topic that we don't cover in detail. We discuss what the behavior is, But to really cover that properly, you need to start heading into a quantum field theory realm, and that goes beyond the things that we cover in the book. All right, let's go browse through the chapter. Relativity and the Dirac equation. Our quote is from Dionne Warwick, a singer. If you can think it, you can do it. And I love that motivation for quantum mechanics. We can certainly think of quantum mechanics. That means we can do it. So deriving the Dirac equation is not really that simple, but we focus on the ideas of Pauli, which said that if I look at a Hamiltonian that was equal to p squared over 2m, or I look at a Hamiltonian that's sigma dot p quantity squared divided by 2m, they're actually the same thing because sigma I squared is equal to 1, and sigma I sigma j plus sigma j sigma I is equal to 0 when I does not equal j. However, if you then do the substitution of p goes to p minus q over c a of r and t, where a is the vector potential, you actually can derive that g is equal to 2 from this Pauli expression when you look at the coupling of the spin to the magnetic field. And that really has in it the key that guides how one constructs the Dirac equation. We then have to start from the relationship between energy and momentum, that e squared is equal to p squared c squared plus m squared c to the fourth. And we use that. I have a little discussion that shows, motivates where that comes from. But we then use that to help us figure out how do we derive this Dirac equation? And the idea is that we use something similar to what Pauli did, where he found sigma dot p squared was equal to p squared. Well, here we have to work with a more complicated thing. We have alpha dot p times c plus beta times mc squared, where the alphas and the betas are now 4x4 matrices. But when they're all squared together, it will equal p squared plus mc squared. And so we can use that to then find a linear equation by essentially factorizing it that becomes the Dirac equation. And that essentially is the Dirac equation once we've added the potential to it. We, of course, have to figure out what these alpha and beta matrices are, and that takes a little bit of work, but it's straightforward, not super hard, because it relies a lot on the properties we already know about the Pauli spin matrices. It's very interesting to look at the non-relativistic limit and verify that we indeed do get the proper Schrödinger equation, so we go through that carefully. Then we look at what happens when we look at central force problems. In particular, we want to look at total angular momentum because it turns out that the orbital angular momentum no longer is conserved by the Hamiltonian, but interestingly, the total angular momentum, the spin plus orbital angular momentum, is conserved by the Hamiltonian. This actually complicates the way that we work with things because we liked being able to work with states that have definite orbital angular momentum. Now we can only work with states that have definite total angular momentum, and that's linear combinations. And this is part of the complications that we get into when we look at solving the problem. Our next section is working out how we get the relativistic hydrogen energy eigenstates. We talk a little bit about energy scales, and we eventually are able to massage our Dirac equation. We actually did most of this work in the previous section into a form that looks just like the equation that we solved using factorization previously. But you see there's an energy in this equation 16.43. There's an energy that appears on both sides of the equation, which means the energy is going to go into our ladder operators. And indeed it does. But the process is really very straightforward, very similar. It's a little messier, but very similar. But in the end, we then have a self-consistent equation for the energy, which we can solve, and we get this formula for the energy in 16.48. That's the exact result for the energy. We plug in what the factorization results are, and we have a couple of different cases depending upon whether our total angular momentum is L plus a half or L minus a half. You got to go through all these details. It's a little bit of a pain. We then work out the rest of the factorization chain. Even though this looks messy, it actually works out relatively easy to work those out. And then we can look at the different energy levels that we get. After that, I should point out, there is one extra solution that you get that you can't rule out, but it has a completely wacko energy. And there are techniques that you can use to rule it out. And so we have a little bit of a discussion about why that is and how you can get rid of it. Then we look at the relativistic wave functions. This requires us to do some projection operators to get the system from a 4x4 equation to a 2x2 equation and then to a scalar equation. And then we have to use the projection operators to go back to first a 2x2 equation and then to a 4x4 equation that has a solution as a Dirac 4 spinner. It's just algebra. None of it is particularly complicated, but it's so easy to make a mistake. So this really requires special care to go through and get everything to work properly. But the technique that we use using this generalized Rodrigues formula, that works again. So you can see here all these nested commutators. Again, it is a little bit messy and the notation is unpleasant and you just got to stick with it to get through everything. But it's not super hard to work through and get all of that to work. And then we carefully work out in detail what the results are for the 1s, the 2s, and the 2p states. And that kind of covers all of the different kinds of behavior. And now when you look at this image, this is showing you the difference between the relativistic solution and the nonrelativistic solution for the wave functions. And you can't even see a difference on this plot. They're essentially the same. Okay. There are very small differences. It's because the effects are really small. They're like one part in a thousand or smaller for the corrections. But they're there, and there are some subtle things that occur in the relativistic solutions, such as the wave function now diverges as you go to the origin, and that is a complication that you have to deal with. There also are some very nice arguments related to Witten supersymmetry, which, as I've mentioned before, is closely related to the factorization method that we've been using. And then our final section talks about fine structure, the Lamb shift, and the experimental implications. And there's a lot of interesting results here that tell us about the different kinds of splittings that you will get in the spectral lines of hydrogen. Essentially, all of this is known exactly. The Lamb shift can be calculated perturbatively to quite high accuracy, but we don't have an exact calculation of the Lamb shift. We also talk about how things would work in a quantum field theory and what kinds of effects are pure quantum field theory effects that you really need to get to quantum field theory in order to work with them. And that finishes chapter 16 on the Dirac equation and relativistic hydrogen. Hey guys, let's do quantum right.